private official image registry. So those images came there, and then when it says okay, when it is labeled okay in the official, it means that Nginx or the company really is the one maintaining and did the image. So just like Nginx there and the phone there. Okay.
So let's pull the Nginx.
So yeah, that's how you get an image. You have to pull it like that. So let's try to run or execute the image. Image has been executed, and this is what it looks like. By default, if you installed Nginx, it really would look like this, right? So yeah. Mm-hmm. So let's take a look at the command. So what did I do? So dockerized is the command to execute an image. So -d means detach, because I did it run -d, then there will be blank space here, and then there will be logs on that specific image. So in that case, if I refresh this, then you will see the access logs like this. So it will show like that if you didn't do that. And then what else? So -p is like port. So you map port 80 of the host, which is my laptop, to the port 80 of the container. So Nginx by default is exposed to port 80, so it mapped the host port to container port. So if you go to localhost like this, which is port 80, then it will port the network traffic to the port 80 of the container. So yeah, and what else? So Nginx Alpine, this one here is a tag. So it could be, if you take a look at this, the tag is latest, but I use Alpine. So to define what Alpine is, it's the lightweight image distro. So I think it's 5 MB, right? 5 MB compared to like Ubuntu, Mint, and so on. CentOS, and yeah. So yeah. So let's go back. Okay. So that's it for Docker images. So we try to execute it. So now there is Docker container. So you remember me, you saw me do a Docker run. So that image became a container. Okay, so containers can be defined as an executed image. So yeah, like I said, I execute that image. But one more thing is a container is I would rather define containers as static images that became a process. So what it means is, by the way, this command $ps shows all the running containers. So if you take a look, these are the labels of, or the metadata of a container. So the container ID, what image is used. The command is changing the G table, so it's not data. Let's just say that this is table of. So this is very similar to what the service engine start is. And but the difference is it's a continuous process. So yeah. So yeah, for this that. So port, this is the host port map to the container port. Names is stupid. Actually, the names are
a bit random.
Yeah, random. If you didn't specify a name for a container, it will randomize something. So you saw that. So yeah, the process here is this Nginx-g name. So you can call this actually container. The best definition of a container is the decay process. So yeah. So go back. So One more thing, they are not mini VMs. So when we say mini VMs is, because most people think that containers are like mini VMs, so, but they're not. So what's the difference, right? I mean, they separate process, but the main difference is,
wala silang guest OS.
Yeah, one that's one reason, but yeah, but okay. So yeah, continuing. When you say mini VMs, like you're doing virtualization, and in virtualization, you set resources to each of the mini VMs. Let's say 1 GB for this mini VM, 1 GB for this. Let's say yeah, 1 GB for that Ubuntu mini VM, 1 GB for that Fedora mini VM. So yeah, the case for that is sometimes. Some resources will be wasted. You only use the 70% resource of that mini VM. So that's what virtualization is. With containers, it's the same. You can use or you can separate OS as well. And yeah, you can separate OS as well. You can have a container with the Ubuntu image or Ubuntu OS. You can have a container with the Fedora OS. But the difference is that they are using only one host resource. And like in virtualization, you set or allocate a resource for a single VM. Unlike in containers, yeah, they use the same kernel, they use the same host resource. So which means that you can max out whatever resources you are using within that host. So yeah, it saves resources. So containers versus images. So an image is an application that we want to run, so Nginx. A container is an instance of that image running as a process. So yeah, like what I said, when you do Docker run, that image will become a process. So yeah. So Docker network. So basically, Docker has its own private virtual networking. Each container connected to a private virtual network is bridged. So each virtual network routes through NAT or network address bus day port, firewall on those IP. So what does it mean? So what, like I did earlier, I mapped the port 80 of the host to the port 80 of container. So container is actually isolated inside the Docker daemon. But with this, with visual network, with this, it routes through Docker daemon routes through a NAT firewall to make sure that the outside network or traffic reroutes to the container. So yeah. So Docker daemon has stops that lets Docker daemon has an out of the box stops that that reroutes the outside traffic to the internal virtual networking traffic of a container. So yeah. And then wait, sorry. So all containers on a virtual network can talk to each other. So that was what that is what Docker network does. So by default, containers are isolated and they do not know that other containers exist. So let's say I have like earlier an Nginx container. Let's add a Postgres container. Let's add a Python container with a Django application. So since these three are isolated, they don't know each other. So what you need to do is to define network, link networks to make sure that they can communicate each other. Maybe Nginx will do a reverse proxy to Django, or Django will communicate to Postgres, connecting it. So yeah, using it as a database. So wait, sorry. It is secure. So what do you call it? So containers are not open to the outside network. So for it to be open, you need to do what I did earlier, the port mapping. So what? Like what I did earlier, port 82, port 80 of host, port 82 container. So that's what makes it secure. It's isolated and it's private. So let's say I have a message queue container like RabbitMQ. So messaging, so you need to define a port for RabbitMQ. I think the port for RabbitMQ is 15672. So you just need to expose the port of the container, and you can communicate it inside a Docker daemon, inside a private virtual network. And so yeah, let's make it secure. But in some cases, you have to open the port of the virtual machine or the physical server. So yeah, You cannot do like or hack via example.com port 543.1.5.6.7.2 because that port is not open, but only the container port is open for that. So yeah, only the inside containers can communicate that RabbitMQ message container. So yeah, but if you're going, but yeah, things could be, you could ask that, how are we going to communicate through, let's say, I did a microservice, so my RabbitMQ is located into another machine. And then I have a, let's say, Python app here. So if things are isolated and secure, how would this Python app communicate to RabbitMQ? So there will be a thing called Docker Swarm. So it's an orchestration, but yeah, it will be another track, it will be another topic, but basically what it does is, even though it is on a different host or a different machine, they can still communicate via virtual private network and via virtual private DNS. So yeah, orchestration for that. Yeah, I will try to explain that in the next talk or in the next meetup. Yeah, so but it's possible with our. And then, okay, so yeah. So volumes. So there are volumes. So bind mount is, it links container to host path. So basically when you change, actually it's easier for this demo, but yeah, but basically when you put files in a container, you cannot, the normal things to do is to copy files to a container again if you want to update or change them. So, there will be the bind mount. So if you change something, a file in your local, then it will also reflect to the container by network file system. So yeah, I'll give a demo later for it to be more clear. And then Dockerized way of storing data, the Dockerized, is the Dockerized way of storing data in a special location assigned to container. So like I said, containers are isolated. So for them to sync some files or directories, we can use volume. So it's easier for me to just give a demo, by the way. So yeah. So let's delete this container first. Real changing real source changing between a host and a container. So see, that's an example for binary. Okay, so and then let's proceed now for the volume. So let's say Daemon. So most likely the processes will run when whichever OS you run it to, as long as the Docker is the same version. So, like what I did earlier, I did a three-tier web app. It's a three-tier web app because there's a DB, the Postgres, the engine for the web server, and Django. By the way, the static one is Angular 4, it just doesn't seem too obvious, so, but yeah. So, if I run that on another computer, like Ubuntu, besides my Mac, I run it in an Ubuntu or I run it in a Windows, I expect that to be running clearly and smoothly as well. So that was what one environment fits all means. So actually that's the primary reason why people use Docker, to make sure that all the apps are running whatever or whatever computer they use or wherever computer they use. So yeah, one environment fits all. So and then instant deployment. If you noticed earlier, what I did is just run this command here, docker-compose-app-d, and everything already went running. So it already run my Nginx, it already run my Django, and it already run my Postgres database. So yeah, that is what instant deployment means for. So yeah, that's what Docker does. But be noted that these are just the basics of Docker. There are so many things that Docker can do, but maybe I'll talk that one in the next meetup. So yeah, we're just gonna do the basics first. And then, okay, so how does Docker get the job done? So Docker pull, I already did this command, so it's basically just pulling the image from the Docker hub. By the way, let's take a look at the Docker hub. Maintains and created this image. So yeah, there are some configurations and tips to how to deploy it, also for environmental variables. So yeah, and then Docker push. So what does this do? Docker push is you can push your image, even your own image, like what I did here. These are my old image, so I did a Docker push there. So actually Docker Hub can be compared to source code repositories like Bitbucket and GitHub. So Docker Run, I did this earlier to make the image into a container. Docker Inspect is to check the metadata of Docker components, let's say this container. So see, what is the network of this container? Where is it linked to? Yeah, the networks, the ports, the volume, so yeah, etc. Okay. And then Docker compose. So that's what I did earlier. Docker compose up dash d. So let's take a little more focus on what does this do. So Docker compose is like it runs. Basically, what it does is it runs, it creates containers, it creates networks, it creates volumes, defined in a single, one single bundled file, single one bundled YAML file. So see here. So it means that I'm gonna have a container named API with an image of Python 2.7. I will do the build in this project folder, and then the environment file. By the way, Docker container can have the environment variable. It links to DB, so containers are isolated, but you can you can tell them that you can communicate to each, or you can assign them communication by using links, at least for the Docker compose. So yeah, entry point is like the start command. When you see ng-g daemon, it can be defined in entry point. So yeah, the volumes, etc. So yeah. So, okay, let's see how this build works. So that project. Yeah. So to be able to create an image, you have to have a DAR file, which simply is like this. So this is an example of the R file. So I got the image, or I inherited the image from the Python official image, and then
this access token is the token in
my account. So and then all I have to do is Docker. So yeah, Docker compose that and then it will pull the images and then create a container. You have to set the environment first. Yeah, so you have to follow this. So your environment here instead of Lua will become on the digital ocean. So Docker machine. So if we take a look at our PS, these are my current containers. So I'll try to go to the environment of my digital ocean graph. And so yeah, I got to find this one. So no containers because I'm already on the environment of DigitalOcean. So I'll run this command again here. And this should deploy my three variables in DigitalOcean.
So
it depends on the thousand but as I said, I think you won't be happy anymore. This is the deployment diagram for that. database. Actually, it's not here, but there's a database here. And API is connected to the database via 45432. The edge is connected to the API via 48000. And there are volumes here. So, yeah. And the static files of under is in the NGX. So what happened? Did we really solve the disadvantages of DigitalOcean? Are you guys satisfied? So basically, what I did is just the deployment and the basics of Docker. But the real advanced stuff will be in the Docker Swarm. Will be on the Docker Swarm topic. So it includes Docker Swarm, just to be brief. It's an orchestration of Docker. It really is developing rapidly. So it does load balancing. It does virtual private DNS. So that's what when I mentioned that Rabbit, even RabbitMQ is in another host, it can be communicated through virtual private networks in another machine or host. So yeah, that's one ability of Docker Swarm. Okay. Yeah. And another thing is there are good images that not as good as what the service offered by AWS and Azure, but at least you have options to in your digital ocean on what others can do. But it's another space that is a problem. But yeah. Because like for security firewall, there's an OWASP image. Mod security, so it's a firewall made by OWASP, which is an open web application firewall sort of project, and you can create firewalls there to protect yourself with DDoS and other attacks. So, okay, one command for deployment, both maybe two or one, but what about no commands needed to deploy? So, besides you've got the Docker basics and Docker Swarm that I just mentioned, there is also Docker Cloud. So, who is this new kid on the block? So Docker Cloud is an improved version of the Hub, Docker Hub. So Docker Hub can just store images and some other stuff is like private, or you can do automated builds. But Docker Cloud is much better on every aspect with Docker Hub. So maybe interesting and fast things. So yeah. But oops, times is up. See you in the next video. But do you guys want to see like a single function of Docker Cloud, like the CI/CD? It will take maybe just 5 to 7 minutes. Yeah. Is it okay?
No rush.
Okay. Okay, let's do it.
Thank you.
DigitalOcean. But what we want is to just push this code update in the, my first code repository with bucket, and then this will automatically be updated. So all I have to do is okay, so let's add this.
Thank you.
Meron pa ang tanong?
Want to